get us started and introduce our speaker for our first speaker for the public track of this Nobis Create Conference. So in this session, Dismantling Creative Limitations, you will learn how to break free from barriers and critics that hinder your creative potential. So we're going to get started on our creative journey together with Ella Hooper, our amazing speaker for this session. You can follow along in your program to learn a little bit more about Ella, but she is a life consultant, a podcast host, a teacher, among various other things. So feel free to, in your Nobis session, sort of click that next session to view a little more info about Ella there. But without further ado, I'll hand it over to Ella to get started on our talk for today.
Thank you, Chloe. Well, it's so good to spend some time with you. I love working with smaller groups because it means that we can really engage. So like Chloe said, my name is Ella. I am originally from Melbourne, Australia, and I started my creativity as an actress. I used to perform a lot, and then I went to an acting conservatory. And then I've been living in California for the past 9 years and actually helped start an art school. So I'm a university lecturer. I believe that emotional health is so important for the artists. So I'm going to give you a bit of a taster of what my class, which is called the Wholehearted Artist, I'm going to give you a taste of what my students experience. And really the design of the class is to give a roadmap to our emotional world in creating, because a lot of us feel burnt out or stuck or in a rut creatively. And so that's what I'm going to take you through. Now, I will do a little disclaimer that some of these topics are bigger than a 45-minute chat. Just be aware that some of the there's sort of all these subtopics that I won't have time to go into today. But I'll start by sharing my screen and we will dive right in. I'm in the wrong part. When we think of creative limitations, a lot of people say that they feel blocked or they feel uninspired, or especially if your job is to be a creative. I know when I studied, it was one thing to be in a play and then another thing to take your creativity and become a professional in it. And then there's deadlines, there's expectations, there's the vulnerability of you're exchanging your value for money or your ability for money. So sometimes those kind of pressures start to limit your creativity and cause you to kind of play it safe. So I want to do a little test. So if you have your apps there, I'd like you to kind of tell me where you're at. So where you're at in your creative journey, and you might not even see yourself as a creative, but I believe that everybody is a creative. So I'll go through. So pick the option that feels that it accurately describes you. So the first one is, I feel uninspired and lacking motivation with my creativity. I worry about what other people think, what the analytics are saying about my creativity. That's one that comes up for me. I feel burnt out, exhausted, and don't even want to create. I feel an unrelenting pressure to perform with my creativity. I'm in a rut. I freeze at the thought of trying something new. I'm afraid that what I create is mediocre. All of the above or none of the above, everything I touch turns to gold. I'm not worried about it. I don't know about you, but my emotions, sometimes when I'm having a good moment, I probably experience that 20 minutes of my life in a month where I feel like, oh my gosh, I'm amazing. And then the rest of the time I'm like battling the storm inside my soul. So go ahead and click the one that describes you. I think the one that comes up for me is I worry what people think a lot. And as a creative, when we start creating for what other people think, it's a very gray moving target. So I'm going to tick that one. And I think, Chloe, if I'm right, it will show up if people start to click, if I click the arrow, is that right?
Correct.
But as a life coach, I work with artists, and these are the common kind of this is the theme that I'm hearing from a lot of creatives. It's like, how do we push through these creative blocks? And to me, I've kind of built up a formula to really start gathering awareness, or a method to gather awareness around what are your limiting thoughts and where do they come from. And so I am going to jump back to what creativity is. So creativity is defined as the tendency to generate or recognize ideas, alternatives, or possibilities that may be useful in solving problems, communicating with others, and entertaining ourselves and others. And that's from Human Motivation. And so a lot of creativity really comes from a clear mind. And researchers and scientists call it a flow state of mind. And I don't know about you, when I've been in seasons of like real overwhelm, it's kind of like really, there's so much mental clutter going on inside that it's actually helpful to do an exercise that I'm going to take you through to really start identifying what are the voices that are holding me back from reaching my creative potential. So again, if you had a minute, if you can go in and select which one that you most identify with. And I think when we're thinking about our creative habits and our creative practices, we have to get connected with our why and our identity. So how we see ourselves. And I love James Clear is awesome in speaking to, he has a book called Atomic Habits. And he says, every action you take is a vote for the type of person you wish to become. No single instance will transform your beliefs, but as the votes build up, so does the evidence of your new identity. And I love talking. I work with New York Times bestsellers and producers and actors, and they have to, in order, you can't really say you're a writer if you don't sit down and write regularly. And so what Atomic Habits encourages is actually little atomic habits, like 5 minutes of writing every day, and then you start building up the habit and the muscle of consistency. And that becomes a vote for you are a writer, seeing yourself as that. And I think sometimes we can even be not see ourselves as creative or not see or be so at the mercy or reactive to all the tasks that are coming across your desk. So if you're working and your job is creating content, there's all these pressures coming at you. It's hard to get really clear about what your why is and what your focus is. And then sometimes it's really hard to even communicate to our bosses what we need and where we're at, because we're just kind of living in reactivity to everything coming to us. So I always teach my clients, like, let's strip it all back and come back to who are you? How do you see yourself? Rather than seeing yourself as this burnt out, exhausted, overworked person, let's come back to your true design and how, and get connected to what you're passionate about again. I talk to a lot of creatives who have lost their passion because they're so motivated by the voice of shame that says you're not doing enough, that everyone's going to find out that you're not as talented as you say you are. And so what I like to do is quiet all the noise and get connected back to who are you? What do you love? What makes you come alive creatively? And then actually forecast the future. So I'd like you to reflect on the following. So who will your future self be in 1 year from now? What do you want to feel about creativity? So, and you can share this in the group if you feel comfortable, but yeah, so your prompt would be, and we'll take like 2 minutes to do it right now. In 1 year, I want to feel productive and passionate about what I'm creating. So, and you might actually need more time on these reflective questions. And obviously these are just prompts. So see what comes up in you as you do this. So if you want to feel productive and passionate about what you're creating, you might put that in the year. That's how you want to feel. Because often we like make goals about like what we want to achieve, but really, I think that our subconscious is a lot of what's motivating us and driving us. And really we're doing that because like, I want to win the Oscar because I want to feel significant. And I think a lot of movie stars will share like, when I won the Oscar, I didn't feel any different. And I thought it would make me feel significant or influential. And so I like to, when goal setting and thinking about your future self, like, what is it that you want to feel? And in 1 year, what do I want to be doing? And this is a great question because sometimes as creatives, we're spending a lot of time on maybe menial tasks or tasks that are really draining. So I would even sometimes like what's helpful is to actually write a list of what you don't want to be doing. So I might even go, I don't want to be doing administration. or I don't want to be doing, I'm trying to think, these designs that I've been doing a million times over. And so I have an example of one of my good friends. She worked for Facebook and she now works for TikTok, and she was a part of their design team. And she was one of those people, if you have Facebook, you know how the 5-year anniversary comes up and they like hand, like they have these animated features that clap hands or whatever. So if you're kind of tracking with what I'm talking about, she does those, she used to do those designs, but she was finding like that pressure of being in, obviously Facebook and TikTok have great reputation. So it's a very high performing company. And then that pressure that puts on you to really play it safe creatively, because you're like, well, it works, like I'm just going to keep doing that. But then feeling like your heart's not fully coming alive and your heart's not really engaging in your job. And so she decided to challenge herself to take a risk and actually try different forms of design. And I'm not a designer, but she decided to get out of the box and push herself and rumble with the fears that come up of like when you're getting out of your comfort zone creatively and you're going in to try something new, you have to be bad at it. So she gave herself permission to be bad at it. And now she's more of a senior designer at TikTok. So there's sort of been payoff in our risks, but a lot of the time we have these voices that hold us back and keep us in our comfort zone creatively. She also has this story because she also had a big Instagram following where she did hand lettering design. And then because it got so popular and everybody loved it, she ended up, kind of freezing because she felt like this pressure of like, what if this doesn't get that many likes, or, you know, and so it kind of put her in this creative rut of only being seen as this like a lettering person. So she had to disrupt that and come, and she brought herself into more animation, but that meant she had to have a quieter season where her work wasn't as popular on Instagram, but it actually served her in the long haul. So it takes risk to be a creative. And so I want you, as you ponder on this, and you're going to get an email so you can come back to these questions in a second, but you can kind of ponder and be inspired about like, for my future self, how do I love my future self well? And what risks do I take to get out of, you know, the rut that I find myself in creatively? So moving on to the next space, this is an exercise. Clearly I'm not a designer, but this is an exercise I take people through, and it's inspired by Brené Brown's book, Daring Greatly, and a talk that she does called Why Your Critics Aren't the Ones Who Count. And so she talks about like when we create or when we do something brave, which I think that creativity is one of the bravest things that we can do. And I think there's a stigma attached with creatives being seen as emotional or all of that, but it's because they're constantly putting their hearts out there. And so she talks about like reserving seats for your critics. And I know, I don't know about you, but when I'm about to do something brave, I want to pretend that the critics aren't there. I want to be in denial about that. But in her talk, she actually talks about when you're about to step into what she calls the arena, and she talks about the Theodore Roosevelt quote, when you step into your brave space, and my brave space I put as a stage, and yours, your brave space might be your workplace. It could be a conversation you have to have with a colleague. These are the voices that kind of come up, and you want to, the way that I would dismantle like the limitations, I have to kind of put things into categories. So I have to kind of go, what is the voice of scarcity saying? Now, scarcity could be there's not enough money. I'm not going to be able to earn enough on being a creative. I don't have enough resources. Or if the workplace you're in is like, we only have budget for this, and you want me to do this big grand thing with this tiny budget, which a lot of creatives are kind of dealt with. They have to be creative about their budget. So that would be an awareness, and you'd start writing down whatever voices, or it could be a person, it could be your dad saying like, why would you get a career in creativity? It doesn't pay anything. And then there's the seat of comparison, that which creatives, we can get stuck in that a lot. And Brené Brown's research shows like that we have upward comparison and downward comparison. We do this thing of like downward comparison is looking at your colleague being like, well, at least I wasn't as bad as them, or at least I wasn't as, I don't know, I'm not late to meetings all the time, and that person is, at least I'm not as bad as them. And then upward comparison is, well, I'm not as good as that graphic designer who's been here for X amount of time, and I'm constantly comparing and even competing towards that person. And so it's just being aware of like how comparison shows up for you in the workplace. And then once you can be aware of it, you just reserve a seat for it. You don't over-identify with it. You don't judge that you feel that way. You don't judge it. You're just being an observer. And then shame can be, the seat of shame can be a voice that is, it's like Brené Brown describes it as, you are bad rather than you did something bad. Guilt says I did something bad, and shame is I am bad. And when I'm working with artists, a big one is imposter syndrome, especially for people who became very visible overnight. It can feel like, oh, once they find out I'm not that good, are people going to find out? And so we want to reserve a seat for that. And then you have your cheap seats and your box seats. So your cheap seats are the people, like I imagine, like if you posted something on social media and then you had someone critiquing and they don't have a profile on there, their Facebook profile photo, and they're just kind of shooting off negative critiques, but they're not actually putting work out there themselves. Or they may be an auntie, which I have an auntie who critiques everything but doesn't actually show up in her life. And then you have the box seats. And so the box seats are the people that create the rules of the world. So the rules of your workplace, that might be your boss or your manager, that might be a client. And so sometimes like when we walk into our brave space, just imagine you're walking onto the stage of your work environment. And some of you are on Zoom work calls. So it could be you jumping on a Zoom call. You're aware that you want to have these box seats in that. Like you don't want to pretend that they're not there, because they actually do deserve respect because they built a company. But when we put them on a pedestal, or when we over-identify with them, or we get so consumed with what they think about us, that can consume our creativity and our focus. So really the goal is to really connect back to the you seat and the safe people, the people. And if you have one of these friends, you are rich, because safe people are really key. They're the friends that will probably, like, let's say you failed at work or something happened, they're going to be there for you. They're not going to pretend like, oh, it's not that bad. They'll be like, yeah, kind of sucks, but we're here for you. And then your you seat is you, like what actually led you to work here in the first place? What's important to you? What are your values? And really connecting in with those values. Because I think sometimes when I've gone through seasons of burnout, it's because I've come out, I've lost my vision for who I am and lost my vision for what my values are. And then once we start getting back into that aligned place in our identity, we can start kind of making decisions from that place. So when you think through, you do this exercise, and we won't have time to fully go into it today, but you'll start to kind of think about, like, what is the voice that comes up every time I walk into my workplace? Oh, am I struggling with scarcity? Am I anxious about money a lot? Or am I anxious about comparing myself to my other work colleagues? And just start being aware of where your thoughts are going. Research shows that we have about 70 thoughts in a day. And just think through, like, how many of those thoughts are on a loop. And the way that we actually, and I won't have time to go into it today, but the way that we actually disrupt the loop is actually by building a new belief system. And that is through some mindset work. But I think we can't really change something until we're aware of it. So that is the focus of today. So quick question. So the cheap seats, we want you to give the correct answer for this. And I'm going to send through some terminology so you understand all my little terminology, so you can look back when you do the exercise. You can look back there. So the cheap seats are the people who create the rules of the world, the most supportive friends, the people who share their criticism but aren't living their life in the brave space. So for the sake of time, I'm going to click the right answer is that one. So the people who have a lot of opinions but are not actually doing anything. So you can just reserve a seat, but actually take your focus off them. So I'm going to watch this quick 2-minute scene with you. And now we're bumping out of the brave space being the workplace into a brave space being a ballet conservatory. So I don't know if you guys have seen the movie Center Stage, but we're going to watch this. And I want you to be able to identify, like, what are the seats that are showing up? Is it scarcity? Is comparison? And I want to use this example, and then we'll go to the next question. So let's take 2 minutes to have a look at this.
I know, I wasn't myself today. I didn't get enough sleep last night, so I was really tired.
It's not just today, Jody. I see you 3 times a week. You're not improving.
I can work harder.
Oh, no matter how hard you work, there are certain realities about you as a dancer that we have to face. We can wait till the end of the year when it's time for you to get a job, but we can talk about it now. I still have options. You're not very turned out, so that needs work. And you don't have great feet. And while you're very pretty, you don't have the ideal body type.
Margot Fonteyn didn't have great feet.
Well, Margot Fonteyn was on stage. You couldn't tear your eyes away from it. Yeah, people. In 4 months, we're going to put on a workshop in front of 3,000 people. It's an audition for every major ballet company in the country. From what I've seen, I can't cast you in that workshop. And if you're not on stage that day, you won't get a job, not at ABC, not anywhere.
So what, are you kicking me out?
No. I just want you to really think if this is the right place for you.
So yeah, I think when you go, if any of you have gone to an art school, there are those hard feedback moments. So we're going to go to the next question, which is what seats were on display in that scene. And I just see, I have a few people in the chat. Oh, Megan, I love that you love center stage. Great. Okay. So what seats were on display? Were the box seats? Was scarcity, comparison, shame, or all of the above and more? And so I want you to go ahead and just click what you think, but just for the sake of time, I think that you would have been able to see that the instructors, I think the actor's name is Peter Gallagher, I think his name, but he would be in the box seats because they are the professionals that create the rules of the world. And they really do dictate in a lot of ways where this person's career goes. Scarcity, comparison. I think, you know, there was a comparison to Margot Fonteyn. And so that's where comparison showed up. Scarcity could be like, I don't have enough talent. Shame could be my body's not right. And this is an interesting thing that we as artists and creatives have to kind of rumble with the realities of if you are in ballet or if you are a designer in a workplace, there are certain standards and realities that really sort of demand excellence. I think where our identity takes a hit is when we start going, my value, my worth is you're saying something personal about me. So even though like the instructor, the head of the program was talking about her body, he wasn't necessarily shaming her. He was more saying like, as a ballet dancer, you need to have X, Y, and Z. But she could have interpreted that as shame. And that's where I'm like reading into it. So I'd like to use that example with students and with you guys, just to be aware of like, wow, we have these brave moments in our careers, where we have to kind of rumble through the negativity. And the beautiful thing about this movie is in center stage, I don't want to spoil it too much, but she ends up finding and innovating her own perspective. And that's really the goal and the heart of what I do with clients is to kind of go, well, I'm going to pave my own way that feels authentic to me. And she ends up, yeah, I won't spoil the ending, but she ends up being a part of a new company and really getting to dance and do what she loves. So she kind of gets to create her own rules. So I'm going to tick all of the above and yeah, and all of them are right. So either way is good. So then I want you to think about, and we only have about 10 minutes left, so we won't fully go through this exercise. You're going to get an email and you can always watch back the video to kind of hear the explanation again. But write down what your brave space is, the critical voices, and just focus in on your workplace as your brave space. So this is a personal exercise, so you may not really want to share your answers with the group. But you might start to write down, so you might write down your U seat, your, box seats and your cheap seats. And you might just put down I would put down my auntie because she always was really critical, but because she was an older person in my life, I would constantly be thinking about what people in the cheap seats think of every time I post something or every time I do something that feels authentic. I would come up against that. And then, scarcity, like could be not enough time, not enough resources. It could be those things. So go through in your own time and figure out that. And we might have room for one question at the end. But yeah, so I'm going to leave that exercise with you to really think through, like, when I'm about to do something brave, what are the voices that try to hold me back? Because that moment before you do something brave, let's say you're going into an interview or you're about to get some feedback about your work, you're having a meeting about that. Before you go in, and I like to call it the waiting in the wings, like before you go on stage, that's when your research shows that you're most prone to shame. You're overthinking, like, what are they thinking about me? And you're overthinking, like, who you are as a person. And so that's something to be aware of, like, that your self-talk wants to be really gentle and kind towards yourself. And in the Brené Brown talk, which you'll get, she talks about, like, the goal is not necessarily winning or losing when you step out and take risks. It's actually about following your core value of being courageous and showing up. So celebrating, like, coming out of that experience, whether it was an interview or a meeting with your boss, you would come out celebrating yourself, saying, I'm proud of you for showing up today, because it's brave. And celebration is a huge, self-celebration is a huge thing that's going to help you kind of move through those brave moments. So we want to tune into a different channel. If we had the AM channel, the AM channel could be the voice of criticism and accusation and feels very threatening. And we're comparing ourselves. We're in that scarcity mindset. Whereas the PM channel is the abundant. It's coming out of that fixed mindset into a learning mindset. So especially as you're taking on trying new creative ventures, that is where you want to really learn to have a compassionate internal voice towards yourself. And I won't go into it today, but there's a practice called self-compassion, which is research-based. And that is, the research shows that when you feel better about yourself, you actually make better choices. So some of our burnout comes, not because someone is pointing the finger, our boss is pointing the finger saying, you're failing, you're doing the worst, you're not as good as X, Y, and Z. It's actually like our internal voice, that part of those 70,000, you know, 70,000 thoughts we have in a day. So we're wanting to tune into a more kind channel, and which is challenging, but there, I would highly recommend you looking into self-compassion research. So this is my last sort of question. I want you to think through, what are your limitations? And this is really a primer to get to you working on, like, the how part of implementing the new belief system. But just think through what your glass ceilings are, or your limiting beliefs. So I put down the example, I could never, like, this could be a, I could never earn over 100K in my creative field. These might be limiting and they might feel very true, but part of, like, getting into an abundance mindset is really, like, coming into a belief that as a creative thinker, you can reframe your experience and think through, and actually find testimonies, stories, and create expansion of, like, people who have similar stories to you and how they innovate to come out of that kind of box that they find themselves in. I know an example in the entertainment industry, Reese Witherspoon to me is an expander, because she was kind of in that rut of, like, kind of being fed the kind of the same roles. And then that, because that was the rules of the world, that women only played certain roles up to a certain age. And then she's like, do you know what? I'm going to start my own production company. And so she starts her own production company. And now she has so much content out there that's super popular. and diversified. And so she would be an example of someone who has expanded your belief system to go, actually, I can push through a glass ceiling. I can actually, you know, believe for something more for myself. So yeah, go ahead and you can share that your answers to the group if they don't feel too vulnerable. But yeah, it's sometimes really good to just kind of put it out there, the glass ceiling that you want to smash through. So Brené Brown, I've quoted her a lot today, but she says, there is nothing more vulnerable than creativity. It's not about winning. It's not about losing. It's about showing up and being seen. So I want to encourage you, and we'll go into my last final reflection question in a moment, but I want to encourage you, as artists, we live in this moment, feeling of simultaneously wanting to hide and wanting to be seen. And we want to be seen, but we don't want to be seen. But part of creating opportunities in our creativity is showing up and being seen. So I want you to just think through, like, what does it look like for Ella to show up in her work? What does it look like for me to step out of hiding and actually share ideas and actually rumble with that vulnerability? So the final question, and you're going to get an email about this, is what I find, like, we have these reset moments. You might be on the call today and come up with this awareness of, like, oh, I've been listening to the voice of scarcity so much, or I've been listening to the voice of comparison, and then that's overwhelmed me and caused me to, like, go into survival mode trying to prove myself, and I've taken on all these extra tasks that I actually don't have to do. So this might be the moment where you take inventory in your life, and what are you saying yes to and what are you saying no to? Because I think coming back to the James Clear quote of really taking actions towards the identity you want to be is learning how to sometimes risk to rest. So maybe not bringing your work home on the weekend, because rest will fill you up and give you more inspiration. You might be saying yes to rest, and you might be saying no to working on the weekends. You know, so have a think about those and really start to take action from that place. So I think we have a couple of minutes left, do we, Chloe? Great. Are there any questions? I'm going to come out of my... Do you have any questions on the call today? Just before we wrap up. And yeah, any questions? We only have a couple of minutes left.
But I loved when you were talking about the imagery around the seats and everything. And when you were talking about losing clarity, what is something that helps sort of bring you back into, or bring you back out of that rut? Is it just sort of like the safe people in your life, sort of thinking about those things that help bring you back?
Yeah, I think safe people are really good to process with. And I think getting a coach or a counselor is because you want someone non-judgmental. And sometimes what doesn't help us be clear about decision-making is sometimes when people project their fears onto you. And then I think the, yes, you're safe people is something, but I think part of it is, like, once you do this exercise, and again, I take people through this over 13 weeks, so it's quite a extensive, there's so many keys to this exercise, but really look at your fears. So for me to really take action, and, like, I have to rumble with the fear I have around finances. I have to look at what it's like to step through fears of what people think. So if I'm going to post something on social media, like when I first put out a podcast, there was all these fears of what people would think, or that it was just mediocre, and all these fears. And so I actually had to take action. So taking action, because sometimes we don't get clarity because we haven't worked through the fear. Like, sometimes we don't want clarity because we're like, I'd rather stay in my comfort zone. So that's my thoughts on that.
That's really good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I'm definitely going to go back in and excited to get those emails and stuff. But this has been a really great talk.
Oh, thanks, Chloe. Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of these questions are very personal as well. So yeah, taking the time to reflect and kind of go through your own brave space, you'll find some other things come up and you'll find probably, a bit more clarity around what your next steps are. Yeah. Awesome. Great. Well, we might wrap up on that note. You're going to get some emails from me, and you're going to get an email that has the link to the Brené Brown talk and terminology. So you can go, what was the cheap seats again? And then you just look in what my terminology says. So keep an eye on your emails and feel free to go through the exercises. Great.
Thank you, Ella. That's awesome. And thank you, everyone, for joining as well.